All right, good morning. Welcome to Oak Bridge Community Church. For those of you that are in this room, and then for everybody that's watching online, we just want to say welcome, and we are looking forward to an exciting, great day worshiping our King, learning more about Him and what it means to follow Christ. So again, we're just glad that you're here. And I wanted to wish everybody, if you're in this room, did you guys know that today is Grandparents' Day? So that's not laid out. So I'm wishing that to myself with two of them now, right? So that's we got a lot of old folks in the room then, it sounds like, huh, here? So we got just a couple announcements. One is we're finishing up the series this week on Somebody's Gotta Say It. Tom's finishing that up. Next week, you're going to hear from all three of us, Josh, Tom, and myself, and just on a few different topics. So look forward to that, and then we'll start a new series afterwards. As far as reopening, October is still the goal. So we are monitoring schools. We're watching and seeing how that goes, and it seems like some good things are going on. So we are putting, getting all of our plans together and figuring on October for that. So just continue to stay alert and to pay attention. And then also have a couple of announcements here. One is the first Saturday in October, which is October the 3rd. Am I correct, Greg? You're in there? Yep, October the 3rd. We've got our annual golf tournament. So we would encourage you. You've got this week, right? By next weekend, you have to have your team in. So team captains, guys jump on that. I haven't signed up yet, so I'm just kind of waiting to see the competition since I am the defending champion, and I'm just kind of looking back. And again, as I say that, I kind of had a stacked team, so that helps out things. But seriously, get that in. That'll be a great time. Hopefully the weather will be nice, and we just get out and kind of enjoy the great outdoors and chase the ball around a little bit. And then also starting this Wednesday, a lot of our groups, small groups, are starting up, and some of them have chosen to meet in homes. Some of them are kind of laying off this semester, and some of them are going to be meeting up here at the church. But a good alternative to small groups, because it's going to be a little difficult getting plugged into new ones and things, starting this Wednesday, I'm going to be doing Toolbox every Wednesday night up here at the church in this room at 7 o'clock. And you're more than welcome to come up. There's plenty of room where you can space out. And where the format's going to be is I'm just going to teach for probably half hour or so. That's actually going to be live streamed as well, so if you can't make it up here, you can watch at home. And then after that teaching, we're just going to have some question and answer time, and we're going to start this first topic, this first series. It's going to go however long it needs to go, is just some tough questions that people might have really about Christianity. Things like, how could a good God send people to hell? How could again there be a good God, and yet we look at the situation in this world and there's so much evil that's rampant? How does that flush with the God that we see in the Bible? But I'm going to start off these first week and probably at least 2 weeks, and the question that I'm going to go over is really just, why Christianity? Why is the Christian worldview different, unique? I would say the correct worldview compared to all others that are out there. And so we're just going to look through really what I'm answering to myself is, why am I a Christian? Why am I still a Christian? Why have I hung in there? Why do I still follow Christ? And I think that'll be a good one. So Wednesday night, you're more than welcome to come up or watch it live on stream. But I think that's about it on the announcements. Are you guys ready to go? All right, I'm going to say prayer first, and then we will get started. Father in heaven, just we are grateful. We're in awe of who you are. And Father, I just pray and thank you for your grace that you give to us. I thank you that we've just that we've come off a summer season where we've been able to spend plenty of time outdoors and swim and do the things that happen in the hot weather. But Father, I also am grateful for the changing of seasons and just for the consistency that you show, that we can bank on it, that you have set things up in an orderly fashion, that you are a God not of chaos but a God of order. And Father, we thank you for the weather that's coming and just the fall and the things that brings with it. God, I know that many of us have been impacted in just some ways that we might look at as negative, we might look at as tough, we might look at as situations we don't want to be in. But Father, we know that in this world you've promised that we'll have problems, but you have overcome the world, and we can rejoice in the fact that you are true and faithful and right, and your word never comes back void. So Father, we praise you if we're going through good times, and we give you the credit and the honor that you deserve. And Father, we also praise you if we are going through tough times, because our joy and our peace does not come from circumstances, but from the person and the work and the love that you have for us in Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Why don't you stand up if you're in here, and if at home, please join along.
heart I'm tethered to. With every step I collide with you. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing into me. You never let me down. You don't know back, relentless in pursuit. And every turn I come face to face with you. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing into me.
I'm really grateful for that truth, and I believe it maybe now more than ever that his love for you and his love for me really is fierce, and it's beyond our wildest dreams. And I'm learning that just over the past couple weeks in a fresh, new, exciting way in being a parent. So I am a father now, yeah. Thanks. Super excited, baby Georgia Louise, 12 days old. It is pretty crazy. And I got a text in the hospital, a lot of texts in the hospital, and one of them was from a friend named Stacy, and she said, "It's just amazing, isn't it? Like, I think it's probably the clearest picture that I've ever had," this is what she said, "of the love that God has for us as his kids." And I do, I'm learning that as God's a father, and if he's a perfect father, how much does he love me as his kid? It's crazy, like how much I love this little human who really can't do anything for me right now, you know? Like, I just stare at her, you know, and I just, like, can't take my eyes off of her. At night, you know, even in the middle of the night at times, I get excited, not all the time, but I get excited when she wakes up just to see her little eyes again, you know, like I'm excited to get home after this to be able to hold her. You know, I love going on walks with her. I you know, there's 9 Mile Gardens right by our house. We go, and it's like we're both like, this is so much more fun with the baby on our chest, you know, and I've learned, like, one thing specifically that I'm learning in this season for me about the love of God through how much I speak over baby Georgia. Like, how many scriptures I've recited over her in 12 days, how many baby hymns, essentially, like lullabies that I've sang over her, how many different like declarations over her future that I've said in 12 short days. And many of you are parents in here, and many of you love Jesus, and so you've said very similar declarations and similar prayers, and you've sang similar songs over your child, but not the exact same ones. Like, these are personal. This is my baby, right? Like, I have some pride and excitement that this is my girl. And this is what, like, this is what I'm learning, is that even for a 12-year-old girl, like, the words that I speak to her and over her are dependent, really, on the circumstance that she's in. Like, if she's crying and being a pill in the middle of the night, like, I remind her and I remind myself, hey, I'm gonna love you forever, even when you are really, really frustrating, right? Like, when she's sleeping, I'll remind her that God never sleeps, that he's with her and he's gonna wake her up in a couple hours. Like, we could go on and on down the list. And I think it gives us a picture of what God wants to do for us maybe in this season. When many of us find ourselves in difficult circumstances, when life seems to be a little bit dark, I believe that God wants to speak over you. In fact, in this time period, I've kind of been studying on the intimacy that God wants to have with his kids and the way he wants to speak to us. And it's wild how many passages there are about how God speaks over and how God speaks to his kids. And right now, like, my baby's learning, and she's an infant, and she's probably not super familiar with my voice yet. But for many of us, we've been Jesus followers for a really long time, and we got to grow up, and we got to listen, and we got to become familiar with our Father's voice. Like, I love what Jesus says, my sheep know my voice, and they follow me. They know me, and they follow me, and they listen. And so the question is, are you listening? Are you listening? Are you listening to a personal heavenly Father who I believe wants to speak directly into your life in a unique way, maybe even in this moment? And I think we have a gift over the next 5 minutes. We're about to sing a song that talks about the light of Jesus. And I've had a lot of conversations with friends, family members, loved ones, and many people have expressed in this time period that just the darkness and the weight of this world seems so dark and heavy right now. And maybe for the next 5 minutes, a personal, loving, heavenly Father wants to remind you, no matter what kind of darkness and weight you're facing, maybe he wants to remind you that darkness stands no chance against the light of Christ. No chance at all. And so I'd encourage you just to listen, to be emboldened, to be excited over the next 5 minutes, and go to God in worship together.
we just come to you today, so thankful for the name of Jesus, name that is above all other names. And it doesn't matter where we are in the darkness and our shame, you are there for us. We thank you that we cannot hide from you. You will always find us. You will always comfort us, and you will always protect us. God, we are so blessed to be able to come here today and praise the name of Jesus, the name that stands above all other names today. God, we give you all the glory and all the praise today, and we thank you. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Well, good morning. My name is Tom Noblitt. I'm one of the pastors here at Oak Ridge Community Church, and I wanted to welcome you guys online. So glad you join with us every week. And if you're new, then hopefully you'll enjoy today. We're in the final of this series called Someone Has to Say It. This is week 7. If you missed it, I think it's been a great series. Anybody? There's a few people in here, maybe at home as well. But I think you should go back and watch it. And I think it's worth seeing today. Hopefully God has got something in store for us again that he's put on my heart for quite a while. And then next week, you're going to see an interview of all three pastors. I'm going to try and make it a little, what would I say, upbeat, zesty, opinionated, feisty. How can I say that? I'm going to be feisty with Herc and Josh. And I'm already telling you right now, I'm getting tired of hearing about Josh's kid, just so you know that. I mean, I'm too much. Herc and his grandkid, enough. Let's talk about Jesus. Okay, no grandkids. You know, that's hypocritical of me, but you get the idea. Anyway, tell you guys a few stories today. I'm going to challenge you with something that's basic. I'm going to give you a basic strategy, I think, which I'm not going to say it. It's a strategy of Satan. He's been using it from day one. It's nothing new. Satan is creative and he's smart. He is. But he's not omniscient and he's not God. He's fallible. He's got problems. So, and I think this has merit of what we're going to talk about today, because I believe this is exactly where our culture is at today. And I think it's something that if Christians don't respond to this, I think Satan may win the day, win the year, win the century, on and on. You get the point, in our country. So here's a few stories, and then I'm going to just try and hit a point just right where we all understand it, we all get it. It was my junior year in high school, and I was president of an organization called the FCA, the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. And at that time period, it's kind of weird, by the way, because I wasn't sure I was a Christian. I mean, it's kind of a weird deal, but I was president of it. And we went from home to home amongst these students that were in there, and there was about 15 of us, 15 to 25 of us that were part of that group. So we'd meet in each person's home. So it came time to be at this one fellow's home, and when we go in there, we step in, the mom answers the door, and I can see these plastic runners on all the carpet everywhere. Now, I don't think if you're young, you can understand what I'm talking about, because I haven't seen those for at least 30 or 40 years. And then all the furniture was covered in plastic. So there are plastic runners, there's plastic furniture, and I'm thinking, at that point, I'm thinking, I don't know how well this is going to go, bringing in a bunch of kids in there. We're not in there in the front living room. We're not in the front living room for more than 20 minutes till one of the kids gets up, and you know, you don't want to step on the carpet to put a footprint, and he walks along the thing, and he goes over to the piano, and he starts playing around with the piano, just jacking around. He couldn't play. And all of a sudden, I see the mom come peek around the corner, and she looks at the guy's name, and I won't say his name in case he's watching, all right? And she said, "Is that necessary?" And we all could hear it, all right? So we put that down, but here would be the point. How do you think it felt for all of us for the 2 hours we were in that home? Right? I mean, it felt like you were in a cage. It felt, you know, antiseptic. It didn't feel normal. It was not good. What do you think that she valued? What do you think the value in her house? Apparently, what she valued was cleanliness of some kind. I don't know what her total deal was. We never went back there again to have any more FCAs. And but you got the idea of this culture, and this guy who's a friend of mine, I kind of understand a little bit now how he is because of some of this upbringing. That's one story. What did it feel like? Was the culture of that house had a specific culture, and how do we feel being part of it? Well, here's another one. A few years later, it's my sophomore year in college, and I'm going to Jefferson Junior College, and I got an apartment down there. And it's my sophomore year, and there's a roommate. They've got 6 apartments together. The room next to the apartment next to mine was where this guy stayed, and his name was Barry. I'll give you his name. He was the best player on our team. He was the best athlete I've ever seen. He was the 6 foot, his name's, he was 6 foot six white guy that could jump out of the gym, that was built like an Adonis. If you thought Hercules walked into the room, that's exactly how this guy was. All right. He had it all. Looks. He was so strong. I mean, it was unbelievable. He was fast. He could jump. Phenomenal. He had gone to a four-year school, a major four-year school, University of Mississippi, and transferred after his freshman year to where we were there at. But he was just great. And I noticed now and then he would get a bloody nose. And I'd say, but Mary, what do you got a bloody nose for? And then I realized as time went by and he didn't really answer, I realized that Barry was a major drug user. And during the summer between his freshman year and sophomore year, he had done so much cocaine that he had ruined a lot of the membranes of his nose. So he just had constant bloody noses. I remember going to his apartment next door, and he said, hey, come here, I want to show you something. He used to tell me, could you imagine how good I would be if I wasn't high or drunk every time I played basketball? What I'm trying to tell you is, this guy was NBA all-star quality. I've never seen a better player, never. I'd go into his apartment next door, and he'd pull out his dresser drawer, the top dresser drawer, just like a dresser drawer, and you'd pull it out, and nothing but pill bottles. Nothing but pill bottles. Nothing but drugs. And I was, you know, I'd never drank beer. I'd never been around that. I'd had no concept of any of that. And he asked me one day, he says, hey, Tom, I got a delivery coming. Could you sign for it? Now, I had enough sense to think, I'm not going to sign for anything for Barry. The package came as a small package, and came from Florida, and it was a little box of drugs. And he wanted my name on the thing. I didn't sign for it. But just to tell you another thing just about him, there's one day I'm in the room, and I'm playing like Monopoly. So this side, I'm playing Monopoly. This side, they're doing hardcore drugs and whatever. I just kind of look back and think it's kind of funny. And I respected Barry as a person. I mean, I liked him. I did. I just knew that he, total different culture. But I smell something burning, and it's at Jefferson College. The power had gone out, and down there at that time period, man, when the power's out, you can't see anything. Couldn't see the hand in front of your face. But I smelled something burning. I go next door, and Barry has a metal pan on wooden floor burning wooden leaves. His floor's burning up below it. So he could have burned down the office. Barry, what are you doing? And he was so out of it at that time period. So here's the points. How do you think it felt being around Barry? I mean, it was a weird culture. It was a weird deal. It was a total, you know, one time I'm playing Monopoly with a friend, another time I'm dealing with Barry and worrying that he's going to have a needle in his arm. I mean, it was a weird deal. What do you think he valued? What do you think he valued? I mean, it wasn't the stuff that I valued. What do you think he valued? That's just a question. So you understand, his culture, Barry's culture, was totally different than my culture. My first friend's culture was totally different than my culture. All of these are different cultures. Well, I had one just yesterday. Listen to this one. It's a little bit different. I'm down at the Oak Ridge City Church, and I pull in line at Chick-fil-A, right? God's chicken. You get the idea. I pull in line at Chick-fil-A, and I have a gift card. Pull in line. There's about 15 cars in each line, but they're outside taking your order. So I'm like six cars in, they take my order, and as friendly as anything, they said, what's your name? I said, it's Tom. They said, my pleasure, of course. They took all the order, no problem. I said, look, I need 3 ketchup, and I need 2 barbecue sauces. And I know they're going to be exactly 3 ketchup and 2, and I said, I only want 1 salt. I don't throw away a bunch of salt, so don't give me a handful of salts. So I know there's going to be 1 salt in there. Being overly picky, right? Get in line. Move about 6 cars up, and I'm still 4 or 5 cars away from where you get your food. They come out, and they give me my food. And the gal says, as she brings it to me, the lady says as she brings it to me, she says, hi, Tom, here's your food. I'm still in line. By the time I got out, which was 4 cars later, I had my French fries ate. Do you understand? They delivered it. They took my order almost right away in the thing, pulled forward a little forward. Before I'm even up to the window to get out, they're bringing me my order. And I'm eating my order as I'm going out. Now, you know what? I sat and thought about that. I thought, what an amazing culture of service. I don't care how much it cost, right? They weren't even thought of it. I knew that they cared. That culture of Chick-fil-A, it's expensive. Is Chick-fil-A expensive to you guys? Yeah, I hear somebody say, yeah, yeah. If I get a salad, a 12-piece nugget, and a soda, I mean, I'm at 10, 11, 12 bucks. I'm at Texas Roadhouse money right there at that point. But, you know, I thought, this Chick-fil-A, they crush every other fast food chain, every other chain. It's like, when you look at the numbers, it's like embarrassing. And they're doing it in 6 days. These other people go, how do they do that? I'm thinking, look at their culture. It's a service culture. You can't, it's like when I go to other places, I say, you got to be like Chick-fil-A. So you realize the culture makes a difference. Here's what I read this week, and this is kind of where we go now. I want you to think of those cultures in your mind. Here's a statement that you're going to read up on the screen. I'm going to put it up here. It's this. The crucial differences which distinguish human societies and human beings are not biological. They're cultural. Now, let me say that again. I'm going to read it again. I just want you to get it. This was written by an anthropologist. I won't tell you who it was. It wouldn't make a difference to you anyway. You wouldn't have recognized this person's name. The crucial differences which distinguish human societies and human beings are not biological. They're cultural. They're cultural. They're cultural. So in other words, when you look at a group of people, it's really not their skin color that distinguishes differences in people. It's the culture. If you go down to Haiti, they've got a different culture. If I go to the Netherlands, they have a different culture. You have a different culture amongst your family units. I have an aunt. I used to have an aunt, and her name was Aunt Edna. I loved Aunt Edna, except there were a couple problems with Aunt Edna. In high school, so I'm going back now 40 years, Kathy and I dated my wife during that time period. We'd go back to Indiana with my family because that's where my mom and dad were from. They moved from Indianapolis out to St. Louis. So we'd go back to see the family. And Aunt Edna was my mom's sister. So when we'd go back to Indiana, we'd say Aunt Edna had plenty of rooms in her house, but we'd never stay at Aunt Edna's. We'd never stay at Aunt Edna's house. We'd go to somebody else's house, but not Aunt Edna's. And here is why. Her house was always dirty, and it was always messy. And I remember thinking, I went downstairs to her basement, and there were piles of clothes, like little prairie dog mounds everywhere. You couldn't walk in the basement. And I remember thinking about that, thinking, man, I don't get it at all. Well, now that I have a house and a basement, I fully understand it. It's no problem, I get it. And the house always smelled like bacon. There's always something cooking, bacon or kind of burnt hamburgers on a skillet, whatever there was. There were always dishes in the sink. So I went to spend the night there. I'm going, no, I don't want to spend the night there. And my mom kind of felt the same way. So then I realized as I got older that her husband, Uncle George, was a great guy. He owned a construction company. And he worked in the dirt. They had the big diggers and all the big, heavy construction material. He worked in a construction company, so he constantly came in with dirty clothes. He had three sons that were older than me, but they worked all the time too. So they're constantly changing out of dirty, sweaty clothes. And now I started to understand, with three boys, with a guy that works hard all the time in construction, that's why there are piles of laundry everywhere. I even get that, even without the construction part of it. With three kids, I understand piles of laundry, how quickly that happens. Well, then I realized the eating part of it. We watched the three grandkids this week. Now, here's a grandkid thing, so I get grace. Herc and Josh don't. Watch the grandkids all week. You know, I tell you what, for a 7-year-old, a 5-year-old, a 2-year-old, they consume a lot of food. We were feeding them the whole time. I looked at my wife, Kathy, I said, what am I, just a cook? I mean, that's what I kind of felt like during this. So they're consuming. So no wonder Aunt Edna's house smelled like bacon and hamburgers all the time. She was cooking all the time. No wonder there are dishes in the thing. She was doing dishes all the time. But you know what else I thought about it? She raised three great kids. She loved them dearly. She was married to her husband, George. I don't know how long it was. They were together. They seemed very happy. See, what I realized that the culture of my Aunt Ned's was, she didn't really care so much about having the house clean. She cared a lot more about loving her family. Now, I'm not saying you can't have both, but she made a choice and said, I'm just not going to worry about it. Her culture was, I'm not going to wreck my family to have this. I understand. So as I got older, I thought, you know, what does she value? She valued love. She valued spending time. She valued, pick whatever you want to pick. And I love Aunt Edna. Her culture makes a big difference, doesn't it? Isn't that weird? I'll give you one more story, then I'm going to kind of get to the heart of this. When we first moved into our house, which I don't know how long ago it was. Kathy can correct me on it because I know whatever I say is going to be wrong. But I think it was 35 years ago. And I don't mean about her. I mean, I don't know the date of it. I think it was 35 years ago when we moved into our home, roughly. And when we moved into our home, we bought the parking lot of the, there's show homes on the circle's cul-de-sac, and there are four homes. So he said, we're going to sell off the parking lot. So we bought the parking lot and built our own home. So the parking lot was nothing but dirt and gravel. So when we built the home, we didn't have it soldered or anything yet at that point or anything like that. So when we moved in the home, there was nothing but dirt in the parking lot around the house and kind of gravel. The first thing we built was in the backyard, we built a basketball court, a 30 by 40 slab of concrete, 30 feet wide, 40 feet long by concrete. There was no grass. There was no fence. So the trustees came up to us and they said, we just want you to understand, maybe you haven't followed anything, but there is no garages. You can't put a garage off your house in your backyard. You can't do that. I said, garage? I said, that's a basketball court. Who doesn't put a, I mean, so the first thing, I mean, we didn't have furniture in the house when we had the basketball court. So you're saying, well, why is that? Because my culture I grew up in, my family was, sports was paramount to us. So it was like, can you have life without sports? And the answer is no, you can't. Basketball was just part of it. And I put up a goal at one end and a goal at the other end. And I got to admit one thing. Kathy would say the same thing. It's probably the best thing that I ever did. Now, what's so strange about that is, a month ago or a couple weeks ago, I guess, my son sends me a picture, Matt, in Atlanta. And he says, I'm so excited. Guess what he had put in his backyard? A basketball court. So my culture, my values had gone down to him. He puts in a slab of ground. He gets the measurements of it, puts in a goal there. I watch him playing basketball on that. You understand that how you grew up affects other people. The culture of your family affects other people. It's really that powerful. Culture influences and shapes decisions. I don't care whether it's a business, a charity, a school, an organization, a community, a city, a county, families, or a church. Your values influence your culture, and your culture influences everything. Okay? Chick-fil-A, I like their chicken, but what makes them is their culture. Amen, yes or no? It is. And the good restaurants that you're starting to find out now, the good fast food restaurants, they're imitating who? Chick-fil-A. Because that culture, they're not changing their menu, they're imitating that. That's that important. So, I just wanted to show you something and tell you about this real quick. When we started the church, we came up with 10 values that we prayed about. This was 17 years ago. Whether it's authenticity or the church is the hope of the world or the Bible, all 10. I'm not going to go over all 10 right now. I'm just telling you, those have been our guidelines. So when you come to Oak Bridge, if you come to Oak Bridge, you should realize there is a culture. There is joy and fun is one of our values. So it would be total in line with me to make fun of Herc, my brother, Josh, my nephew. That would be in total in line. You understand our values as a church and our culture. They shape things. And I've been to some churches where their culture is totally sick. It's a bad culture. It's a bad culture. It's not a right culture. It feels narrow-minded. It feels straight-jacketed. I grew up in a church that was a good church but had some culture problems. I mean, grew up when I was 16 and started dating my wife, Kathy. I saw a church, and we went to a church, our first church, and it was a little narrow. I remember the first time I saw a person come in wearing tennis shoes. And you know why I remember it? I remember the hair on the back of my neck stood up because I was upset because he wore tennis shoes into church. If you're wearing tennis shoes right now, could you leave? No, I'm just kidding. Don't. But the culture was you wore your Sunday best. The statement was, well, God gives his best. You wear your best. That's how it was. Now, I don't stand by that anymore. I mean, obviously. But I remember that was the culture of the church. The culture makes a difference. And we have values that make a difference. So here's where I'm going to take a turn. Real quick. the value that a church should have that's worth its weight in gold is it's all about Jesus. It is all about Jesus. Not about your pastor. It's not about some list of rules that you have. It is all about Jesus and who he is and the truth of who he is. That's what it's all about. Paul writes, get this. When I read this to you, you should hopefully understand this a little bit more, but Paul writes letters to churches that are believers in Christ where it's supposed to be about Jesus. And we know these letters because they're named like Galatia, Ephesians, Corinthians, and so forth. He's writing letters to these churches. So I'm going to read three. One that he wrote to the church in Rome, one that he wrote to the church of Colossae, and one that he wrote to the church in Thessalonica. And what he's addressing is for you to succeed, for your church to be a light for Jesus, for your people to thrive, for your people to have the abundant life that Jesus promises, for your people to understand that how you live your life should be attractive to other people because of this principle, because of these principles, here's what I'm teaching. Here's what I wrote in Romans 12:2, the first one. All right, this is Paul to the church. He says, do not conform to the pattern of this world. Do not conform to the culture of this world. Could be translated. Do not conform to the culture of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. He says, don't be transformed. Don't let culture change who you are. You have to be renewed in your mind regularly by going back to his word and understanding who Jesus is. See, a church can slide from being all about Jesus to being all about them or all about some rules or all against somebody. They can slide. And Paul says, you can't conform to the pattern of this world. Now, you'd have to understand the pattern of that world at that time period 2,000 years ago was exactly like the pattern of our world today. It was exactly the same. And I'm going to make a case that we're more like that time period then, now, maybe than I've experienced in my life, but we've always been kind of like this. He wrote to the church in Colossae, get this, Colossians 2:8. He says, see to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition or culture and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ. He's speaking at church in Colossae, different things. He says, watch these human traditions. Watch this culture that's going to invade you. Be careful of it. Then 2 Thessalonians 2:15. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold fast to the teachings we passed on to you, whether by word or by mouth or by letter. He's making a statement. Culture can corrupt the church. Culture can corrupt your family. You have to watch culture. And if I throw in right now, what's your family culture? What's your team culture? If you're 15, what's the culture of your sports team? Your cheerleading squad, the band? What's the culture that you have as you age in life? What culture are you creating in your family? What's the culture where you work? What's the culture of the teachers right now? You may be worried about getting stuff done. I'm more worried about the culture because that's what's going to affect the kids. The culture. What's your culture? That's the big question. So back to Barry, my friend who's a great athlete that did way too many drugs. So I was speaking to Barry one night. I said, hey, Barry, I've never seen your mom and dad at a game. No, they don't come. I said, what's your family do? I mean, do you have a family? Yeah, I have a family. I said, what do they do? He says, they grow marijuana. Now, this was 40 years ago. It really wasn't legal to grow marijuana. I said, well, do you have any siblings? He said, yeah. I said, they're in another state. I said, what do they do? He said, they grow marijuana. I said, is your whole family into this drug culture? He said, yeah. Now I understood. Barry hardly had a chance, did he? Unless he could get something that got him off of conforming to the pattern of his life, unless he had an experience with Jesus, he's a good guy. I like Barry. Barry's one of the nicest guys I've ever met. He wouldn't hurt anybody except himself and the people that he sold drugs to. He didn't have a shot, did he? See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition, which depends on culture. You know, I've tried looking up Barry, Googling his name. I can't find anything on him. But unless something got him, unless someone shined a light on him about there's a better way to live, I would guess right now Barry's dead or in prison or has been in prison multiple times. Now, I'm not trying to tell you that culture is totally responsible for Barry's behavior. Don't hear that. Right? So if you've got somebody that's struggled with drugs, I'm not blaming you. He had choices to make, and Barry was a smart enough guy. He knew. I talked to him enough. Barry, do you really think this is good for you? No, he'd make a joke about it. I'm just saying culture does impact people. Yes, it does. We just got to admit it. It's true. I titled today's message, Death by Culture. Subtitle, there's three things culture is killing today. Three things. Now, when I say culture killing today, I could tell you it's killing the same three things 2,000 years ago. Culture can be a killer. Culture can be healthy, and it can be toxic. You can have a healthy culture, and you can have a toxic culture. You know that. I'm not telling you anything you don't know. You've been in healthy cultures, and you've been in toxic cultures. You know what that's like. You've been in healthy relationships that have a value system and culture to it. You've been in toxic ones. You understand what that is. So here's the three things that culture can kill. I'm going to hit these rather quickly. When I hit these, hopefully the light bulb shines on and you realize it's not a biological problem. It's a culture problem. It's not a biological problem today. It's a culture problem today. First thing culture kills, it can kill truth. We live right now. It's said that the internet has been able to give out more information and facts than any time in our history. And that's true. Hold that right there. Hold that thought right there. We can get more information at any time in our history. Okay? Herc and I were talking this morning. We were pretty sure it's Grandparents' Day today. I turned on Google. I said, let's find out. Google, is it Grandparents' Day? Google said, yeah, it is. Got it? So we can get information everywhere. 2,000 years ago, you didn't have much access to information at all. No printed press, no printed word. So what you heard from a lot of people was their opinion. It was the age of the opinion. We're not in the age of the information age right now. Our culture's pushed past that. We're back to the age of opinion. It's not the information age. News stations aren't news stations. They're opinion stations. And I don't care if it's on the left or the right. They're giving you an opinion. It's very, very, very hard to find facts or to figure out what's true and what's not true. COVID-19 is the perfect example of it. Mask good, mask bad. You go on and on. It's hard finding actual truth in this world because it's moved away from the information age back to the opinion age, just like 2,000 years ago. I heard this one the other day. I mean, he's talking about truth going away. Commentator. I'm not sure they're being sarcastic. I hope they were. They said that gender reveal parties are now passé. You know the gender reveal party. You know, you got two balloons. They throw them up in the air. You know, hit one with a dart, and it blows up pink, and you got a little baby, or blows up blue, and you got something else. However they do those. It says gender reveal parties are passé. And here's why the person said it. And I don't want to read into it, but I believe they're being real. Here's what they said. You really should wait till a person's old enough to determine what their gender really is. I mean, you can argue, and I know some people would be mad at me for even making that statement. That's truth is just under attack. And culture attacks it. It's culture. We live in a culture right now where you can say the truth, but if it appears intolerant, tolerance trumps truth. And I could go on and on. And I think it was that way 2,000 years ago. That truth, I guess it's the people in power that they determine what truth was. There's no truth. Oh, to move quickly, the second thing is death by culture. What else culture kills? Culture kills grace. It kills grace. Giving people a second chance, the benefit of a doubt, understanding that they did this, but but we're not going to hold against them. We live in a culture right now, it's called the, you tell me what it's called, the blank what culture? Cancel culture. Isn't that right? You've heard the term, you should have heard it. We live in a cancel culture. Somebody lives a life for 30 years, that's fine. They can go back and find something on them that was wrong, admittedly wrong, or questionably wrong, and they're canceled. And I don't care if it's on the left side or the right side, they're canceled. It's a cancel culture. I was thinking about this, and I thought, you know what? There's this guy in the Bible. I kind of like him. And here's why I like him. When things get tough, I like to get aggressive. It's just something inside of me. When things go down, let's go. Let's battle. Let's go. Yeah, I get energized by it. So there's this guy comes into the situation, and his whole nation's being mocked. His family's being mocked. God is being mocked. And he has the chutzpah. He has the passion, the energy to say, I'm not going to take this anymore. Give me a few rocks. Give me a slingshot. I'm going to drill this guy. And if I die, I die. But if not, I think God's going to be with me. His name was David. I thought, he saved an entire culture of people. Crazy, right? Then I read about he became king, and he was hunted down by this guy named Saul, unjustly, unwarranted. Saul walks into a cave. David has the chance to whack him. I would have whacked him. David's had the chance to whack him at that time. He says, I can't do this. This guy's using a bathroom. How's this going to play out? This is not a right story. All right? He lets him go. Then he steps out of the cave, cut off a little piece of his rope, steps, and he said, look, I'm not your enemy. I think, what a character. That's phenomenal character. Then we fast forward a little bit. And he admittedly had committed adultery with a guy named Bathsheba. And admittedly, and it's bad, don't get me wrong, I'm not even arguing this right now. If that would have came out, all right, he would have been what? Canceled. Now, his was very severe. I'm not saying that I would have probably canceled him after he had her husband killed. But with that said, you get the concept. He would have been canceled. I think about Peter, the one who God chose to bring the word of God to all the Jewish people. Peter was good, but we read later on in the Bible where Paul comes to Peter and says, hey, you're showing favoritism. I'm bringing in all these, you want these Jewish widows taken care of. So, you know, you're being a bigot. You're showing favoritism towards them. He'd have been canceled, done, gone. Peter's gone. But can Peter run for office? Well, he's a good guy. Jesus picked him, but nope, he showed favoritism. The cancel culture. That's the culture we live in. No grace, no grace at all. Here's a question for you. Was Jesus rejected as the Messiah by the locals, I'm going to read it as I wrote it, because he would not support the social justice demands of the day? They wanted him to become a political leader. The apostles thought he was coming to take over from Rome. They thought that. I think Judas wanted to force Jesus' hand. He took money, said the people that are coming, the guys that he knew was against. He gets betrayed that night. I think he thought there's no way Jesus will allow himself to be taken into captivity by them. There's no possible way. I will force his hand. He will call down stuff from heaven or do whatever Jesus does, and we will be then the leaders of the culture. And when Jesus didn't do that, then I think there's some followers that didn't see Jesus do that. Then I think there's some people in culture that didn't like the idea that Jesus was trying to even the playing field for a lot of people, trying to raise up rights. Was Jesus rejected as Messiah by people because his social justice didn't meet their desire? Now, that's the question I'm asking you today. Because Jesus doesn't meet your social justice requirements, he doesn't heal everybody, he doesn't feed everybody, he doesn't clothe everybody, he didn't do that at that time period. Because there's brokenness in this world, do people reject him as Messiah? And I am saying, because of culture, they are saying yes. Third thing that dies from this, death by culture, is family. See, Satan has attacked truth. 2,000 years ago he started. He attacked grace 2,000 years ago. And he attacked families. And he still does. The fatherless count today amongst races, the fatherless count today, no dads in the home, ranges from 25% to 70%. When the rate for any of the people that are fatherless, meaning there's no dad in the home, the odds of there being poverty, the odds of there being crime, the odds of substance abuse go way up. When you go into prisons, no matter what skin color you speak to, the common denominator in most people that are in those prisons is there's a fatherless situation they've been part of. It's just the truth. It's the truth. I'm not telling you anything you don't know. You know the importance of an environment with a mother and a father. You know that because you've had it. And either you've been a benefactor of it or you've been a victim of it. You understand that. A single mom today, listen, moms, you're going to be on the poverty level almost undoubtedly if you're a single mom with children. And if you're 18 and below, you have almost no chance to overcome that. And we know in our culture today, it almost takes two incomes to be at a quote-unquote, some kind of medium, what we'd call middle class. We also know this from leading small groups, from being around people. When there's a fatherless situation, anger goes up amongst the kids when dad's not there or the home is broken. That is true. And I don't understand the psychology of it, but dads have a bigger role in shaping the emotional health of children they're finding out. I don't fully get it. So what do you think's under attack today by culture? Families. And when you move past the biological part of it, which cultures have been devastated by fatherlessness? And when you get past that and say, what's the result of fatherlessness? And you can make all the reasons. I don't care all the reasons why you say it got that way. The point is, what's the result of that? The result of that is there's higher anger. There's more crime. It's just the way that it is. So to change that, the culture has to change. It has to, that one single fact, if we could lower the fatherless number, every other negative statistic would go down. And by the way, when you lower that, it's strange, but education and health go up. Meaning when you lower the fatherless rate, when there's more two-parent families, all those other things go up. Now, I'm not trying to discourage anybody. I understand stuff happens. I'm just trying to say that's the reality. That's where Satan's doing the work today, those three. Truth, grace, and family. All right, so as I round this up to close it down, I could spend a lot of time here, and we could push a lot further, but I want you to understand the value of culture and how it's something that we have to watch and manage closely. So the question to be then, what changes culture? Now, you can start with your own family. Today, you can start thinking about how you're going to change your own culture to be more like Christ if you're a Christ follower. That's what you should be. You can think about that. You can look at each other and say, look, let's forgive one another. Let's start anew, see what happens. Those things can happen. Because God can heal hearts. He can do things. Scripture says that love overcomes a multitude of sins. So God's powerful love is strong. But what changed the culture? What changed the culture 2,000 years ago? Now I'm going to just jump in real quick here. 2,000 years ago, you know what the culture was? It just kind of started. In around the year 50 or 60, they started building a thing called a Roman Colosseum. The Colosseum, which still stands today, held 50,000 people packed in at one time. The Colosseum was built with the idea that they'd have gladiator wars or slave wars or conquered tribes wars. They'd come in there. They'd take men, women, and they'd have them fight with animals and one another to the death. Now you think about this culture. Who would pay a ticket to go watch a bear devour a 12-year-old? What sicko would do that? This culture did it. The regular people of the world did it. The elite of the world did it. They packed in 50,000 people to see these bloodbaths. How sick is that? What would change that sick of a culture? You know what changed it? Little group of people that followed Jesus. That started to raise up the values of Jesus. That started to live and not just talk a talk, but walk the talk. And started to love and show grace and show truth. And hold up families and help families and support families and give to families. That's what changed it. And it didn't change overnight. And our culture is not going to change overnight either. And I'm imploring everybody that's listening to my voice right now, you be part of this change. You lock arms with us, with the local church, and you help change this. We can make a better place for our children, our children's children, our children's children's children. And if we don't, then you'll see Colosseums come back up again someday. And the same things that happened 2,000 years ago. John 1:14. Why did Jesus come 2,000 years ago? He came into this culture where there was no grace, there was no truth, and families were just getting just ravaged. John 1:14. The Word became flesh, and He made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, read it to me, full of grace and truth. Why did He come full of grace and truth? That's exactly what we need to hear, isn't it? Here's the truth. Here's grace. Here's the truth. Here's grace. As a culture, we have to be willing to speak truth and offer grace. And we've got the role model to follow. John 1:17, a little while later. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. You know, if you're not in this building right now, I have 7 or 8 months ago spoke to our Mosaic Arts team, and I said, there's some things I want to add to the building, this auditorium. And I said, there's a verse that I believe is increasingly important in our culture and will be until I take my last breath on this earth, and maybe has been for a long time. And I said, would you put that on the walls? And if you look around, if you're in this room right now, you see John 1:14. That's what's on the walls. Because I want you to remember three things. It's all about Jesus. It's all about applying truth and grace of Jesus. That's what heals a broken world. That's what gives a direct path for the people. That's what our church has got to continue to be about forever. That's what our culture needs. That's what your families need. 2 Timothy 3:16. What's going to heal a broken world? It's Jesus, grace, and truth. 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is God-breathed, is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. God's word has got to continue to be upheld, learned, applied, lived, trusted, even if you question it. It's good for correcting and training in right living. And it's the thing we shouldn't be ashamed of holding it up or following it. Matthew 16:18. And the church, get this. And I tell you that you are Peter, and this is the words of Jesus, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades or hell will not overcome it. In other words, the one thing that culture will never kill, the one thing it will never kill, is the church of Jesus. It will not. When everything else is gone, the church will thrive and will live and will move on. And we get to be part of that, part of the actual body of Christ that God instituted 2,000 years ago. To bring what? To bring truth and grace into a culture that was dysfunctional and busted, exactly like it feels, what? Today. Amen? Somebody has to say it. We should live it. That's what we need to do. I'm asking you to check your culture. Keep praying about ours. Father, we come to you. We praise you. And we thank you. God, touch our hearts. Touch each of us that listen. If you're convicting us, God, convict us to change. If we come out here feeling guilty, God, don't let that be. I know you don't want shame to be part of our lives. I know you've taken the shame, you've taken the blame, but you want our hearts to change. God, we give you full right to do that. We know that you've got a second and third chances. We know that love overcomes a multitude of sins. We know that, God, that there's a hope that goes before us that is greater than anything we know. We know that you lead us and guide us. Father, we love you and we thank you until we're able to gather together again, either online, in person, however it is, God. We trust you. We thank you for the church. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Have a great day, and thanks for coming.